I beseech ye therefore, brethren, to present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. I beseech ye, I beg you therefore, brethren, to present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. It's not outlandish. It's not too much. Oh, you're doing too much. No. I haven't. David said, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'll become even more undignified than this. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And then we disconnect these two scriptures, but they go together. They belong together. He says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove. Woo, Jesus, I'm not going to have time today. I already know. I'm not going to have time. That ye may prove. Look at somebody and say, I'm proving him. I'm proving him. I'm proving him. I'm proving his goodness. I'm proving his faithfulness. I'm proof. Lord Jesus, I'm proof. I wish I had time to really talk to y'all today and tell y'all what I was talking to my wife about pay scales. It's a long story. They were talking about who. This is way off the subject, but they were talking about what makes you rich in San Antonio. If you make this much money in San Antonio, you declare, you consider rich. And I read that and I start laughing. Cause that ain't true. I was like, but thinking about where I came from. To the point where I'm laughing at what they say is rich, but I come from the worst part of what they say is poor. I come from the negative. If the government, if there's no income into your house, only government funds, that you in the negative. You're not in poverty, you below the poverty line. That's where I come from. I come from below the poverty line. Till these people say, if you make this, you might not have to clap because you didn't have to climb. I just helped myself. You don't have to clap because you don't have to climb. But I'm celebrating every rung, amen, every step that God took in my life, every step. So I can prove. I'm proof. I'm proof to the people I grew up with, God is good. I'm proof to the people I went to middle school with and high school with that God is. I'm proof. I didn't finish college. I'm proof. God will snatch you out of the bottom. See, our reference to the bottom is incorrect. That's what's wrong. Person who was a TV star from the time he was 14 years old said, started from the bottom, now I'm here. You didn't start from the bottom. I started from the bottom. You started from somewhere in this area. You started from some people's here. If you started where I started, okay, all right. He says, I prove it. What? Prove what? Prove what is good and what is acceptable and what is the perfect will of God. Lord, help me, help them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. And you can have your seat. You can have your seat. Y'all doing all right today? Yeah. All right, beautiful. Let's get into this because I want to help you. But we're going to continue our series on rhythms. Somebody say rhythms. Rhythms. What are rhythms? Rhythms are everyday disciplines, right? They're everyday disciplines. So we've been talking about rhythms for the last couple of weeks. Have this series bust y'all at all? Yeah, kind of. I mean, it's not the heart series, but it's Because we don't want to talk about everyday disciplines. We don't want to talk about things that we have to do that are our assignment. See, there are some parts that are God's assignment. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then there are some parts that are your assignment. God is a if you then I God. Are y'all with me today? We read a little bit of that scripture. He said, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. And we immediately go to God and say, well, where's my healing? I need some land healed. I need my kids healed. I need my finances healed. I need my health healed. And God says, okay, but you missed if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. You didn't even get that far. Pray. We talked about prayer last week. Everyday disciplines, right? We talked about what that means to just pray in the morning. To just take on the discipline of prayer. And I know it's hard. Of course it's hard. You know why it's hard? Because the devil don't want you to do it. And your flesh don't want to do it. But it's just like, it's an exercise. It's a muscle that you got to build up. And some of us will spend hours and hours in the gym, but we won't spend 5 minutes on our knees. And God's saying there's a discipline. We talked about the discipline of discipleship, finding you a mentor, finding you somebody that'll speak into your life, that'll help you, that'll grow you up. There are some places in your life where you need to grow up.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor, just say, you need to grow up. Y'all were scared to say it.
Amen.
Scared to say it. Look at him, shout it. Look at the neighbor you skipped the first time. Because you don't know where they... You don't know what they might say back to you. Look at that one and shout it. Say, you need to grow up. There's some places where I got to grow up. There's some places where God's trying to grow me up. You know that lady on your job you don't like? I call her Sheila because I don't know any Sheilas. If it was a Sheila who attended here, I wouldn't use that name at all. But there's a lady at your job who you don't like. You know what her assignment is? To grow you up. There's a manager at that job you don't like. He don't like me, and I don't like him. I can't stand him. He come around, I just walk away. He be trying to talk small talk to you, too. Oh, y'all don't know what I'm talking about. You like, don't talk to me at all.
Get out of my business.
He'd be like, how them Spurs doing today? You'd be like, if you don't stop talking to me, I don't even like the Spurs. Get away from me. You know that person's assigned to grow you up? They're assigned to grow you up. That person, really. Jesus, I'm gonna deal with some stuff. There's people in your family. They're assigned to grow you up. They're assigned to grow you up. They're gonna prove you. They're gonna prove that, oh yeah, you a Christian, you go to church. Oh yeah. Okay. Even some of them will tell you, they that bold. They just gonna be like, oh no, you some sort of Christian, right? They're trying to prove you. They're trying to prove. This is a test. Look at somebody and say, this is a test. This is a season. God is trying to grow you up, and he's using everyday disciplines. He's using small things, how you respond, how you react, what you decide to do after somebody offends you. The language, that's the word I was looking for. The language that you insert at certain points. He's looking for you to edit your language in certain places. Some of y'all just need to edit. Just run it quick through your brain before you say it. Just run it quick through your brain. Because I'm about to tell this. In Jesus' name, amen. But God said, no, everyday disciplines teach you how to humble yourself, how to humble yourself. He said, if you exalt yourself, then I have to humble you. Yeah. That's what he said. I'm the God who picks one up, puts one down. He said, if you exalt yourself, then I have to humble you. But if you humble yourself, oh, somebody should have celebrated about some humbling, because I didn't humble myself. And that means it's due season for my exaltation. He said, if I humble myself, then he will exalt me. I don't have to defend myself against you, Sheila. Because if I humble myself, He will exalt me in due season if I humble myself. Man, why y'all? Okay, all right. Sorry. If I humble myself, come on. If I humble myself, then he will exalt me. Somebody say, if I humble myself.
If I humble myself.
And so this is the season to humble yourself. And this is where we find Paul talking to his disciples in Rome. Now, I got to tell you about Rome. Rome is pretty crazy. Rome is consider like Washington, D.C., how nothing works. Nobody gets along. Everybody's angry. Everybody's fussing at each other. Everybody thinks they know the right thing. And Paul steps up and says, no, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Holy and acceptable. I beseech ye, therefore, brethren. So first of all, what he does a few things that I'm not going to have time to talk about all of it, but we'll try to get back into it in the new year. But he says, I beseech you, I beg you, brother. Wait a minute, brother. Wait a minute, brother, 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 I beseech you, therefore, brother. What is he saying? He's saying, now, because of what you have done, because of what you have done in your life, you are not who you used to be. Let's talk about that. You no longer a sinner. You no longer a Gentile. That meant something. That meant something because those people were considered Gentiles. And in fact, if you read Acts chapter 15, they had an argument about whether or not to even go preach to those people.
Right.
If they were even worth preaching to. And Peter and his people were saying, man, I don't even know if you ain't going to win over there. I don't know how you're going to build a church when the average age of your church is 24.
Wow.
I don't know how y'all going to do it. I don't know how y'all going to afford to be in a building when y'all don't have 62 members.
Wow, come on. Come on.
I ain't even tell you what the offerings was. It's just shameful. Chauncey, they were shameful.
Yeah.
The offerings were shameful. We'll be in the back counting. There was no credit card. We wouldn't have any, you just had to bring money. I fixed that real quick. You know what I'm saying? People don't have money. People not bringing money no more. We need to do something. We need a Cash App or something. This is before Cash App. I was trying to design a Cash App. I should get paid for that. I need some money from Cash App. Anyway. We needed a GodChasers Cash App. We was back there counting the money. One time, Steve, we was counting the money. It was $69. We had a good service. I preached my face off. I was sweating. And the Lord said, and he did dainty good. Okay, we're going to raise our offering. I'm back there with my brother Nate. We in there back there. It was worse. You know why it was worse, Devin? Because it was 320s. If it was $60, I would have felt better about that. I would have been counting them to 11, 12, 13, 14. It was 320s, 1-5, and 4-4s. 20, 40, 60, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then we had a process where three people had to count the money. $69. So I passed it to Nate. 20, 40, 60, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. He passed it to Tabby. 20. I'm like, I'm leaving. I can't do it. I'm depressed. I can't hear y'all count to 69 no more. It was more than 69 people in the church. And I said, okay, God, I don't know what I'm doing here. And God said, no, just keep going.
Yes, sir.
Just keep going, just keep going, and just keep going. Let me do my, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my faith and turn from their wicked way, then I will hear from heaven and hear their land. I had to prove him, amen. I had to prove him. I had to prove him. And now we get to a place where Paul is saying, hey, I beseech you therefore, brethren. Now you've moved up in scale. You've moved up in position. Now you're a brother. Brothers can't act like Gentiles.
Come on. Wow. Wow.
The things the Gentiles used to do, brothers can't do. I moved up. Now I don't feel I don't feel sorry for Gentiles. I love Gentiles, but I want them to move into the position of brother. Because when you become a brother, all of a sudden you get heirship. Oh, Lord, y'all need to hear me right here. You get a part of it. That's why we don't say male and female. We don't say brother and sister. Well, in some terms in the Bible, it's just, I beseech you therefore, brother. Because what it's saying is heirship. It don't have nothing to do with gender. It has to do with heir. And God said, there's something. Oh, let me help the ladies in here. There is something that I have for you. There is something that I have promised to you. And it only comes because of your connection to the Father. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. The mercies of God. What mercies? The same mercies that got you saved, got you healed. Got you. See, we need to start back testimony service, because in testimony service, you find out why people are praising like they praise. Lord, have mercy. You look at them now and you say, oh, they crazy, but you don't know how far God brought them. You don't know what God did for them. You don't know how God picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet on solid. You don't know what God did for me. You may think I'm crazy, but I got a crazy praise because my God has done some crazy things in my life. And that same mercy, that same grace that inhabits my life can inhabit your life. The same God who rescued me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Pull me. The Bible says his arms are not waxed short. I love that, man. His arms are not waxed short, that he cannot reach down and pull you out of the muck and the mire and whatever you're going through today. Ooh, let me stop and celebrate him. Whatever you're going through today, I declare in the name of Jesus that your God's arms are not too short to pull you out of it. I know you're upset. I know you're tired. I know you've been struggling, but your God hears and he knows and he's about to pull you out of the muck and the miry clay. Come on and celebrate God if you know you're coming out. 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 Say, he's about to pull me out. Lord Jesus, he's about to. Some of y'all, he already pulled me out. He already pulled me out. My grandma used to say, when I look back over my life and I think things over, I can truly say that I've been blessed. I got a testimony. God pulled me out. Pulled me out. And I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, the same God that pulled me out can pull you out. But here's how you get pulled out. Present your body as a living sacrifice. Present your body, present your body, present your body, present your body. Now, something is happening here, and I want you guys to see this, and I got to do this for the sake of time. I want to move you guys along here, but you are being promoted in one scripture. I need the theologians to be paying attention to this. You are being promoted. You are literally getting a raise at every next word in that scripture. He says, I beseech you therefore, brethren. Okay, now I already got a raise to that. Now I'm a brother. I used to be, a Gentile. That's a Gentile word for saying what I used to be. Some of y'all, you don't know who you're sitting next to. You don't know what I used to be. You don't know what the fact that I'm in church, oh, Lord, have mercy. The fact that I'm sitting in somebody's church, oh, Lord, if you really knew me, if you knew where I came from, Leah, if you knew where I came from, you a clout. Oh, you in here? You know what? Some of y'all go here because somebody came here that you know and they really changed their life and you said, oh no, I knew her. It must be something going on at that church. Because no, if you would have known her when I knew her back in the day, there must be really some spirit happening there. I got to go check it out. I'm going to have to visit because something is different about them. You should have. I've been promoted right in the middle of scripture. From Gentile. To brother, to priest. I beseech ye therefore, brethren, to present. See, you had to understand the system of tabernacle. You had to understand the system of tabernacle, which is that you brought your tabernacle, you brought your sacrifice to the tabernacle, you brought your sacrifice to the tabernacle, but you didn't present it. You didn't present it because your hands were filthy. You didn't present it because your hands were dirty. You didn't present it. Your offering might have been clean, but your hands were dirty. You couldn't present it. So you had to immediately hand your sacrifice over to a priest. And there was a place, there was a laver, this is where you washed ceremonially. The priest would walk you through that washing process, and then they would walk you over to a little pit. But you just watched from that point. Because the priest would put your offering on the fire, and he would present it to God. And now you got Paul telling these Gentiles, not only are you brothers, but now you are priests. Lord, have mercy. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, to present. I beseech you. There's something special about presentation. There's something special about being a priest. See, priests had to have clean hands and a pure heart. They had to pledge. Listen, I want to help you right here. They had to pledge never to be married. Because being married would be a separation of who I was, and my affections would be separate, and I couldn't have my affections be separate. So I had to have my affections to God only. A priest has his affections to God only. It's not blinded by anything else. He couldn't eat certain things. He couldn't drink certain things. There were certain times where it would be okay for you to eat it, but never okay for me to eat it. Because I'm a priest. Look at somebody and say, I'm a priest. A priest is a presenter, and he stands in relationship to God. He stands across from God because he is prepared. He is prepared as a person. He has prepared his body. He has sacrificed so much that he can help you with the sacrifice. What's that mean, Pastor Donte? Because some people, they're a priest in your life. You can call them up, and you know whatever you're going through, they can go through it. They could talk you through it. You don't know the sacrifice that it took for them. You don't know the sacrifice. Listen. There's some people you call with your problems. You know how tired they are. But they can't decline your call. You know why? Because they're a priest. I can't decline your call. I'm a priest. I got to answer when you call. I'm a priest. I'm a priest. I got to set aside my time. I got to figure it out because the people need me because I'm a priest. Are there any priests in this building? You said, I'm going to forsake some old stuff. I'm going to forsake who I used to be, not just for me, but for the people who are going to need my help, for the people who are going to come behind me. I can't sit on the sideline. Uh-oh, there it is. I can't sit on the side. I'm a priest. I can't be sidelined. I'm a priest. I got a responsibility. I'm a priest. I got to step into the fire. I'm a priest. During a time of Thanksgiving, there would be no breaks. 144,000 people would be coming into this one tent to present not on Sunday for an hour. Not 200 people. 144,000 people. I'm helping somebody right now. You don't know I'm helping, but I'm helping you. You know what else it wasn't in the tabernacle? You know what? There weren't any seats in the tabernacle. There's only 7 pieces of furniture in the whole tabernacle. Right. None of them are a chair. It's a standing position. Some of y'all, I'm in a standing position. You don't understand. I haven't sat down in years. I'm in a standing position. God can use me. I'm available. I'm in a standing position. Every time you show up to the temple, you can show up day or night. The priest would be available to serve you. Some of y'all have turned, you even hearing what I'm saying now, and you made it religious. But there are some people that you are in priesthood to. You've been standing in the gap for them. You've been praying for them. You've been giving them advice. You've been talking them through things, talking them through situations and circumstances. And God said, yes, yeah, you're a priest. You're a priest. You're a priest. You're a priest. You're assigned the priesthood. And now I went from Gentile to brother to priest. I mean, the only person that could offer that offering to God was a priest. A priest would take your, if you were poor, y'all sit down, y'all making me nervous. If you were poor, you would have little turtle doves. You'd have a little dove, a turtle dove. Y'all know a pigeon is a dove, right? You didn't know that. You thought a dove was only white, but a pigeon is a dove.
Right.
They had their little pigeon. Little best offering I got, Lord. Lord, here's my offering, Jesus. Here's my offering, Lord. Here's my offering. This is my sacrifice, God. I don't have nothing else. Here it is. And the priest would say, okay, here it goes. I take your offering. And I this offering is a substitute. It's a substitute for my sin. Now, this my offering is my substitute for my sin. The greater the sin, the greater the offering. Yeah, we don't talk about that no more. But the greater the sin, the greater the offering. What I had to offer was equivalent to, or was equity with the sin that I did. And I would bring my offering. If I sinned big, I would bring a big offering. That's how it worked. I had to bring a big cow. I had to bring the first and the fat. I had to bring the best I had, and I would give that to God. But I wouldn't give it to God. You know who I would give it to?
Priest.
And the priest would take that offering, and he would go sacrifice it for you. He would show you how to cut it up. I said, a priest is a skilled person. Skilled in relationships. Lord, have mercy. Skilled in saying, baby, you shouldn't have said that.
Wow.
Oh, I know you got mad, but you shouldn't have said that. This is how you cut it up. I know you got mad. You shouldn't have did that. This is how it works. Some of y'all just realizing you in the priesthood right now. You're like, yeah, I'm a priest. I'm a priest. Sign me up. Put a call on me. I'm a priest. I've been helping some people. They call me. They don't call Pastor Donte. They call me when they need some help. And so what they were doing is they would bring their offering. They would bring their offering. And the offering was a substitute for their sin. Gentile, brother, priest. And we get something that's really strange, Pastor Kevin. He said, I urge you to present your body. Wait. I got these turtle doves. And these pigeons. I've been waiting all year. Every time I curse, I'm like, boom. Some of y'all gonna steal that. Next time you feel like cursing, you just go. I got a substitute, amen. I got a substitute. It's a substitute, amen. It's a substitute for my sin.
That's it.
Then Paul says, I want to present because I'm a priest. But he said, no, don't present you. Present your body. Wait. No. I'm okay with killing lambs. He said, no. Now something happened. There was an exchange. Remember, you got another promotion. So it's not just substitute, it's sacrifice. You moved. You moved from a place of Gentile to a place of brother, to a place of priest. But now you moved into the most holy place. And that place looks like sacrifice. That place looks, so you used to have an offering. Excuse me, you used to be an offerer, but now you are the offering. Jesus said, no man take my life. Y'all don't hear me today. No man take my life. I offer it up. I offer it up as a sacrifice. I offer it up on behalf. No man take my life. And our assignment is to be Christian. What's that mean? To follow. D-N in means to follow. I-A-N means to follow. It's to be like Christ. And how? Well, he died. Well, he died. Here's the end of the book. Let me help you. He died. Here's the story of the Gospels. You want me to help you? Here it is. You never read the Bible? Here it is. Let me help you. Jesus died. And if you're going to be a Christian, Jesus didn't say, take up your Bible and follow me. Take up your scroll and follow me. Take up your worship music and follow me. All I want is for you. He said, no, take up your the instrument by which I died. And you got to take up your cross. Wait a minute, I was cool with being promoted from Gentile to brother and from brother to priest. I don't know if I want to be a sacrifice. And Jesus said, then you don't want to be like me.
Wow.
You can say you're a Christian, but until, because I was there. You got to know the Bible, and I wish I had time to go all into this, but I'll take you back to Genesis, right around chapter 3, when the Bible says that Adam and Eve was acting a fool. When the Bible says right around chapter 2, chapter 3, right around that, after Adam and Eve was acting the fool. My mama used to say the fool. You out here acting the fool. You're at the school acting the fool. I know that. If she said that, I was going to get whooped. That's it. There's no I just might as well prepare my body as a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable. Because she was about to give me the reasonable service. The reasonable service. Jesus said, come back. I'm sorry. Come back. Jesus says, I was there. You was where? I was there in Genesis. When Adam and Eve sinned. I was there. Where were you there? Well, the Bible said that after Adam and Eve sinned, they found us a little substitute. Some grass. Some leaves. I don't know what kind of leaves they thought they was going to use to cover up their mess.
Come on.
That's how some of us do. This is how churches are. This is how the modern church is. We dress up our mess. You come to church, you think that hat's covering up your attitude? You think those Jordans are covering up the fact that you got a pornography addiction?
Come on.
We see you. You're a mess. The Bible says Adam and Eve, they saw themselves. I love this part. They saw themselves. They saw that they was naked. What did they see before? That's what sin does. It makes you look on yourself with guilt and shame. It makes you look on yourself with guilt and shame. That's why you got to have the right presentation. Lord, let me help you. I'm jumping to the end too fast. But if you have the right presentation, then you don't have to be guilty about it. Amen. You don't have to be shameful about it. Here's my worship. Take joy in it. Make it your dwelling place. I want to put a smile on your face, God. This is my offering. I present my offering unto you. Adam and Eve took the leaves and tried to cover themselves. God said, what y'all doing? I'm paraphrasing. It's the DRB version of the Bible. Donte R. Banks. Okay. Amazon. All right. So he said, what y'all doing? And Adam said, that woman you gave me. We think Adam blamed the woman, but Adam didn't blame the woman. He said, the woman you gave me. He blamed God. And then all of a sudden they start explaining. I said, because that's what you do when you haven't prepared a proper sacrifice. You start explaining your way through things.
Wow.
Yeah, well, the reason I didn't come to church, PD, I'm sorry I wasn't at church Sunday, but you know the truth is, that's, you feel guilty. I don't feel no kind of way. I want you to be here, but I don't feel any kind of way. No, PD, it's you trying to cover up with leaves. And the truth is, no matter what you do, you can't cover yourself up. It's getting thick. Jesus said, I was there. And I said, where? The Bible says, after all they're covering up, all they tried to do to cover themselves up, the Bible said that God found an animal. Some people say a lamb. The Bible doesn't say that specifically. It said he found an animal, and he sacrificed the animal and used the blood and the garment from the animal to cover Adam and Eve. So because they sinned, something had to die. The substitute. Because of what they did, something had to die. Something had to die. And then there's a process, James. There's a process that starts to happen. And now everybody brings a sacrifice unto the Lord. And until you get all the way to Genesis chapter 22, and then something specific happens. They've been sacrificing turtle doves, and they've been sacrificing lambs, and they've been sacrificing little animals to atone for their sin. And then God says, hey, Abraham, that thing you love, that's what I want as the sacrifice. Wait. I mean, I love my wife. I love my other son. He had two sons. I love my other son. He can't be talking about Isaac. He can't be talking about Isaac. I prayed over Isaac. He gave me Isaac. I asked him over and over. He cannot be talking about that son. He cannot be talking about this son, the thing that I've been working for my whole life. I prayed a lifetime for this son. You know how hard I had to work to get this? I prayed and I cried and I begged and I cried and I prayed. And now you're asking me for that? Jesus. And he said, yeah, I was there too. I said, what? He said, because when Abraham and Isaac, I can't give you all the story, but the Bible says they was walking with their crew, walking with some other people. And the Bible says that he told those people, y'all got to stay here because we're about to go up on this mountain and sacrifice. You know, there's some people who can't go with you to this next level you're about to go to. Some of y'all should have told the church about that. Because you've been looking for an escape route anyway. God said, no, they can't go with you to this next place. And Abraham said, no, you cannot go with me to this place we're about to go, because y'all not going to understand what I'm about. Let me help you right here. There's some sacrifices that you're going to make in this next season that people won't understand. You can try to explain it to them. You can try to say, well, I did this because of this, and this happened because of this. And they're going to say, girl, you won't understand. You won't understand, because as much as God has given me, he is requiring something from me. And I'm not just a Gentile, and I'm not just a brother. I'm a priest. I'm a priest, and I have a sacrifice to present. The Bible said they get up on the mountain. I love this. Well, I wish I had time to talk about all this. Isaac and Abraham, Isaac looks at Abraham and says, yo. I love this because Isaac knew how to sacrifice. How do you know he knew how to sacrifice? Well, he looked at the materials he had on hand. He says, no, I see the wood. Because you know, you make this thing with wood. You know, I see that. I know I'm a priest. I know how to do it. I see the wood. I see the fire. Because you need fire to get a sacrifice. You got to fire. You set the wood on fire. You put the sacrifice in there. So I even see the knife. What I don't see is the turtle dove. What I don't see is the goat or something. We need something. We're messing. We empty-handed. Even a child knows I don't go to God empty-handed. Even a child knows I don't just bring my wood. My fire, my wood. What's my wood? My stuff. Humanity. Wood always represents humanity. Kevin, I said I don't have time to talk about this, and here I am talking about it. Wood represents humanity. That's me. That's my stuff. That's why you got to carry it. Remember, Jesus threw down the cross. We always say he couldn't carry it. He couldn't cry. No, the Bible doesn't say that. It says he put down. He dropped that part because it wasn't his to carry. Somebody else had to carry the wood. They put Jesus on a cross that wasn't his. Wow. He refused to carry wood that's not his.
Right. Amen. Amen.
I got the wood. Fire, my passions. I worship. The knife, my everyday disciplines. My ability to sing. No, I got to cut this out. I got to cut that person out of my life. I got to scalpel this off. My everyday disciplines. But where is the sacrifice? And Abraham says something so significant. He says, the Lord will present himself a sacrifice. And if you don't read that right, if the commas are not in the right place, you'll get a clear understanding that he's presenting himself. Not a sacrifice for himself. He is presenting himself as the, oh, y'all don't hear me today. He is presenting. He said, when you get up there, there's going to be Jesus up there. Let me help you. When you get to the top of the mountain, there's going to be a picture of Jesus at the top of that mountain. When you get to the top of the place you've been struggling about, praying about, asking God how you're going to fix it, how you're going to turn it around, how he's going to do it, all God says is keep going. The Lord will present himself. God will present himself a sacrifice. Does that mean God's going to bring the sacrifice? No. You know what it means? He is the sacrifice. He's going to present himself a sacrifice. Now, Abraham is saying this, and he ain't heard that at all. But sometimes you got to say a thing by faith. I haven't seen it yet, but I believe. I haven't seen it yet, Pastor Kevin, but I believe the Lord will provide himself a sacrifice. I'm just going to be obedient to what God said. I don't know how he's going to do it. I don't know how he's going to fix it. I don't know how he's going to turn it around. I don't know how he's going to change it. But I know what day, when I, forgetting those things which are behind me, I press toward the mark of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. We're going to keep climbing this mountain. Look at your neighbor and say, we're going to keep climbing this mountain. We keep climbing this mountain. And the God, the Lord, the God will present himself. They get to the top of the mountain. And Isaac lays down on the fire because by now he knows what's popping. He does. He knows what's up. We ain't seen no goats. Ain't no turtle doves. It's me. The Bible says Isaac lays down. He wasn't tied down. Ooh, Jesus. There's a picture of Jesus. There are types and shadows everywhere. He wasn't tied down. He laid down.
Yes. Wow.
The son of Abraham laid down to be sacrificed. These are called types and shadows. If you're a theology student, you understand that there's pictures of Jesus all throughout the son. And this, there is no greater type and shadow. There's no greater type of shadow than the son of Abraham deciding to lay down his life.
Amen.
We speculate on how old this kid could have been, but some people say he was 12 to 14 to 16 years old. Abraham was almost 200. He was real old. Now, you ain't seen no 100-year-old person tie down no 14-year-old person. He was a willing sacrifice.
Amen. Amen.
No matter where he was a willing. And he laid down, and the Bible says Abraham takes the knife, and he picks it up, and he picks it up high, and he gets ready to sacrifice his son. And if
he could tie me down,
he can't beat me in a race. This is getting serious now. Brother got a knife out. I'm out of there. Ain't no way a 100-year-old man could beat me in a race. That's not happening. Abraham picks up the knife. And he raises his hand. And he says, Lord, if this is what you want, I'll give it to you. I love it. I pray for it. I beg for it. I asked for it, and you gave it to me. And just like you gave me this, I assume you can give me another one. And yes, this is going to hurt me, but it is the necessary sacrifice. Here it is. Here it is. And he raises his hand, and God says, Abraham! You know what the problem with the modern day church is? Is that we're still following an old assignment. Is that we're still following an old assignment. And God said, Abraham, God is yelling out. He's saying, now the thing that you're trying to kill is the thing I'm using to be an example of a sacrifice.
Yeah.
And the church is killing her sons.
Wow.
Because we're going on some old marching instructions. We missed grace. All we heard was condemnation. Oh, he's switching. Look how he walk. Look how he talk. Oh, I think she like girls. And God is yelling, Abraham! It's a picture of the modern day church killing her sons. Killing her sons. Because she hasn't stopped for a second to hear the voice of God. That's to stay your hand. Stop condemning them all the time. Bring them to church. Bring them to church so they can hear about grace, so they can hear about love. Let me help you right here, because that's the only thing that's going to change them. The law is not going to change them. The law is not going to change. The law is not going to change. The only thing that's going to change them is redemption and grace and the fact that God is still with them and God is staying the hand. When I was young, they used to say the rapture's gonna happen anytime. Be ready. Y'all don't say that no more. I don't know why. If it was true then, it's true now. Be ready. Get your house in order. Let me help you right here. Get your house in order. But look. Why haven't he came yet? Because there's still work to be done. And he says, you gotta work while it is day. For the night soon coming when no man is working. Listen, instead of saying, oh, you're going to get left behind, you know what we need to be doing? Bringing as many people as we can and tell them about Jesus. Because it is his will that no man be left behind. Back to the sacrifice. He has his hand up and God says, Abraham, don't do this. He said, look in the bush. Jesus is in the bush. Again, this is my version of the Bible. Read your own. He says, go look in the bush. Go look in the bush. Go look in the bush. Go look. The Bible says there's a ram in the thicket. Some of y'all need the King James. Let me help you. There's a ram in the thicket. There's a ram in the bush. There is a sacrifice already prepared. You know, you know how long that ram, some people speculate, was in that bush. From the time God told Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, the ram got stuck. And he could not move until Abraham got to the right place and the right time. Woo, let me help you right here. There is something that God is asking you for, asking you to sacrifice. And you so sad about what he's asking you for that you haven't moved into the right place or the right space at the right time to see the blessing that is really yours. Because you're so focused on the thing that you love. And God said, but if you get into the right place and you get, there's a ram in the thicket. It's stuck already. It's waiting on you to get to your proper place. Get your everyday disciplines together. Get your rhythms together. You don't know what I'll do. You don't know how I'll fix it. Get your rhythms together. The Bible says, he said, it's a ram in the thicket. That ram will be a substitute. It'll be a substitute. Because I'm not ready for the sacrifice. You know why I'm not ready for the sacrifice? Because Isaac ain't good enough.
Yes, sir.
He's good, but he ain't good enough.
Yes, sir.
And we need to stop settling for good.
Mm. Come on. Come on. Mm.
Let me move down past Genesis, past the history books, past the poetry books, the major prophets, the minor prophets. We move all the way to the Gospels. And in the Gospels, we get a new ram.
Wow.
Yeah. The Bible says he was born in a manger. Y'all knew I was going to start talking about Christmas, right? It's the first week in December. He's born in a manger. He was born in a manger. And God said, Abraham, you ain't seen nothing yet. Here's my sacrifice.
Wow.
Your sacrifice was good. He laid down there. He laid down there and he was about to take it, but he said, mine will be beaten and bruised for their iniquities. He said, the chastisement of his peace will be, the chastisement of their peace will be upon him, and by his stripes they will be healed. He said, Abraham, you can't beat me sacrificing. You can't beat your turtle dove, your lamb. It's not going to compare at all to the spotless sacrifice that I have. He said, so I'm going to take up my own self, of my own flesh, and I'm going to jump off the balcony of heaven, and I'm going to be born once into a woman. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I'm going to be born into a woman, and I will come through 40 and two generations, and then I will be born once to a woman, and he will live 33 years on this earth, and then he will be beaten, and he will be chastised, and he will be bruised, and he will have the cat of nine tails slap the blood off his back. He will have the cat of nine tails slap the skin off his back. He said his beard will be pulled out piece by piece. You think I'm asking you for something? You want to see the sacrifice? I beseech you therefore, brethren, to present your bodies living sacrifice. You don't gotta die, you get to live. He died that you might live. I would say they put him on a cross. There is nothing that he could ask me for that is greater than the sacrifice that he made for me. Talk about the length of the cross, the crucifixion, 6 hours he was on. He was on the cross. 9 hours he was on the cross. Am I right, Tyrone? 9 hours he was on the cross. 9 hours. Why did it take so long? Why did it take so long? 6 hours. Come on, help me right here. I'm looking around at people. 6 hours, I'm sure. 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock. There we go. Let me help you. I was like 9, 10, 11, 12. Doing this in my head. Multitasking.
That's it.
6 hours. He's on the cross. Why did it take so long? Usually people died. They would suffocate. Especially somebody who had been beaten as much as he was beaten. He was pouring out blood. He would have died sometimes even on the march to Golgotha. I heard a commentarian say one time that when he was on the cross, the angels were going to get every sin, past, present, and future. Even the sins that you have yet to commit. The angels, Lord have mercy, the angels, they went, they flew all throughout space and time, and they gathered up every sin, a representation of every sin. And you know what they did? They put it on the shoulders of Jesus. Every sin, the ones you haven't even committed yet, put on the shoulders of Jesus. So much so that the Bible says God had to look away. God said, no, I can't take this. God, the God of the universe, had to look away because of the sacrifice of Jesus. We have problems with offerings. Jesus says, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. Greek, Father. Father, why have thou forsaken me? Not because of his stuff, because of your stuff. Not because of his stuff, because of your stuff. He carried all those burdens. The chastisement of your peace was upon him. But by his stripes, you are. And then he died for your sins so that you could be a living sacrifice. Mary saw Jesus after he was crucified, but before he had ascended to the Father, she said, Rabboni, is that you? He said, yes, it's me. She started running over to him to hug him. He said, don't touch me. Don't touch me. Don't touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. You know what that means? Sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. You can't touch me yet. You can't touch. Ooh, Jesus, Lord have mercy. Let me help you right here. Whenever you're getting ready to present something to God, people are going to try to touch you. Whenever you're trying to move to a new level in God, people are going to try to hang on to you. People are going to try. You got to be careful when God starts moving you to new levels. People are going to try to wrap their arms around you. You say, no, wait, you can't touch me. I got to present myself holy and acceptable to God. There's something that I have that he needs. I can't be playing around with you. I can't be in every relationship. I can't lay down in every bed. There's something that I have that he needs. It's not about preference. It's about sacrifice. I'm a living sacrifice. I'm a living. There's some things that I want to do. There's some things that my flesh craves. I'm a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to God. Which is my reasonable service. It's not outlandish. It's my reasonable service. God is calling some of you guys right now into reasonable service. And it looks like forsaking my preferences, forsaking the things that I thought were special. Look at that. Forsaking my Isaacs. But God, I pray for this. Yeah, and I gave it to you. Now I'm asking you to sacrifice it back to me. You cannot serve Jesus and not understand sacrifice. You cannot serve God and not understand sacrifice. This is what God's asking you for. Reasonable sacrifice. Reasonable sacrifice. I never gave you my title to this message. Here it is. You ready for it? It's the rhythm of sacrifice. The rhythm of sacrifice. Because once you learn the pace of grace and the rhythm of discipleship, you learn the rhythm of prayer. These are all elementary things in the gospel. Now you get promoted from Gentile to brother to priest to sacrifice. I'm not only the offerer, I'm the offering. If you have an offering unto the Lord today, just yourself. Yourself. That's all I'm asking right now. That just yourself. If you say, Pastor Donte, I want to give myself to God today. Do me a favor and just stand on your feet. And we're gonna celebrate God together. If you say, I'm presenting my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Holy and acceptable to God. Come on, it's all right to clap. I'm presenting my body as a living sacrifice today. Holy and acceptable to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Holy and acceptable to God. Yeah, they're standing up all over the room. Thank you, Jesus. They're standing up all over. I'm presenting my body today as a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to God, which is my reasonable service. I know I owe.
Yes.
You've been so good to me, Jesus. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you want a relationship with this God of sacrifice, repeat this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me for all my sins. Come into my heart. Change my heart. Come into my life. Change my life. Father, today I accept you as my Lord and Savior, and I present my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Come on, let's celebrate Jesus all over this room. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, all over this room. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? I feel like some people's lives will change today. I feel like there's going to be some turnaround today. Come on, let's celebrate Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Come on, you can continue to celebrate him. Amen.